Hallelujah. All is well. Praise God. Isaiah chapter 58. And like I said, the theme, I guess you could say, a while back, the Lord really began to speak to me about seeking God. And personally, to focus on seeking God more corporately as a body, to focus more on us as a body seeking God. And to really begin to dig in God's Word, and study about it, look at some elements of it. It's one thing to say seek God, you know, and a lot of times people say, well, how do I do that? How do I seek God? How do I, you know, pursue God? We hear that was put into different terms, and I heard that all my life, and, you know, you need to seek God, you need to seek God, you need to seek God. Well, one of the things that over the years that in the church it happened a lot when people would say those things, but there wouldn't be any teaching on anybody how to seek God. And, you know, and I realized that in the time we lived at times, I would say something to people and say, well, you just need to seek God. And they'd look at me like, okay, but what do you do then? You know, say to the congregation, let's just seek God. Well, what do you do then? And so I've kind of begun to dig into God's Word and just look at different elements of it. And we kind of use it as a springboard. Jehoshaphat was a man who sought God. And specifically, we went to 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And that is a time when they were surrounded by multitudes of the enemy. And Jehoshaphat's response to that was he sought God. And quite often we find in the Old Testament in particular, gives us many examples like that, where when the problems of life came, they responded by seeking God. And that was never meant to change. That was supposed to be the response of a believer to the problems and the battles of life. It's supposed to be to seek God. And so I just really kind of sought to the Lord's guidance on how to teach that, how to share that. And we've come to the fact that in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, when Jehoshaphat sought God, one of the first things he did was he had a fast. And he declared a fast, and they fasted. Throughout the Old Testament, that's a common response. When the attacks of the enemy come, and they purpose in their heart to seek God, quite often one of the first things they do is they declare a fast, and have a fast. We find in, we go into the Gospels, and we find that Jesus spent time fasting. We go into the epistles or the letters to the church, and we find that quite often they were fasting in the book of Acts. And I went through all this in the book of Acts. You find several instances where the early church was fasting. In the life of Paul, you find quite often, very often mention of fasting. And you go throughout church history, and you'll find a lot of times where people fasted. So that's been a common practice within the body of Christ, within God's people for years. I brought up the point that when Jesus was teaching on fasting, when we talked about motivation, that our motivation needs to be right, that Jesus said, when you fast. He never said, if you fast. He said, when you fast. So it was just kind of understood that that would be part of the practice of a believer. And when I talk about that, that, you know, fasting basically means you don't eat. And like I said, that usually gets a shout. But, and I realize that in cases and instances, there are people who that's difficult to do because of medication and that type of thing. And we will deal with that as we go on and show you some ways that you can possibly still institute that type of thing into your life. But Isaiah chapter 58 is verses 8 through 12 in particular are going to share with us the benefits of fasting. And if you really examine the benefits of fasting, it's phenomenal what God's Word promises to those who fast. And this is where the proper motivation, those who are fasting. But let me begin to read it for a minute. Then shall thy light break forth as the morning, and thine health shall spring forth speedily. And thy righteousness shall go before thee, the glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. Then shalt thou call, and the Lord shall answer. Thou shalt cry, and he shall say, here I am. If thou take away from the midst of thee the yoke, the putting forth of the finger, and speaking vanity, and if thou draw out thy soul to the hungry, and satisfy the afflicted soul, then shall thy light rise in obscurity, and thy darkness be as the noonday. And the Lord shall guide thee continually, and satisfy thy soul in drought, and make fat thy bones, and thou shalt be like a watered garden, and like a spring of water, whose waters fail not. And they that shall be of thee shall build the old waste places. Thou shalt raise up the foundation of many generations, and thou shalt be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of paths to dwell in. And I'm just going to spend a little bit of time in the next couple of services, next couple Sunday mornings, dealing with this passage of Scripture and sharing with you some things about the benefits of fasting. But we're going to start out in verse 8. Then shall thy light break forth as the morning. Then shall thy light break forth as the morning. Then shall thy light break forth as the morning. So one of the benefits of fasting is thy light shall break forth as the morning. And you may say, well, what in the world is that talking about? Well, in the morning it gets light after it's been dark, doesn't it? And we'll find throughout the Scriptures, when we're talking about light like this, that we're really talking about revelation. And I'm going to spend a little bit of time this morning kind of chewing on this a little bit and talking about why you need revelation from God. Talk about why you need to understand this verse and why this is so very important to us in our walk with God and very important to us as a believer. It is promising us here that something's going to happen as a result of fasting. As a result of fasting, there's going to be a breakthrough of revelation. As a result of fasting, there's going to be a breakthrough of hearing from God. And one of the number one reasons that I ever fast about anything is to hear from God. And that's usually why I'm fasting in most all cases. I'm fasting because I need to hear from God about something. I shared, as we were talking about this, that two of the main reasons that I personally go into a fast, there are a lot of other reasons, but the most common reason that I wouldn't do any fasting is one, that when I'm getting ready to preach or teach or whatever, or I'm looking for direction, I'm looking for guidance, it just seems like that channel's not very clear. It just seems like for some reason I'm not hearing clearly from God like I should. And I realize that I need to correct this situation. And the quickest way I know to do it is to enter into a time of fasting until that breakthrough of revelation comes. And that's how I fast usually. You say, how long do you fast until? And usually it's not a long time. If I'm seeking to hear from God about something, how long do I fast? Until you hear from God. I mean, it's that simple, isn't it? And the other reason that most often that I will go into a fast, and again, usually they're shorter periods of fasting, is just if services seem flat. If I feel like, you know, God's not moving in our services and everything's kind of going flat, and then I will enter into a fast until when? Until God moves. Until that's stirred up, until that changes. So as a pastor, those are the two main reasons that I fast. Now, there's a lot of other reasons, and I don't know if I'll get into all of those, but as we go through this list, we'll probably deal with one. But the number one reason that I fast is I need to hear from God. Now, I can almost say that's probably the only reason I fast. Because quite honestly, once I hear from God, whatever I'm fasting about is going to be taken care of. Once I hear from God and get directions from Him, I'm okay. Once I hear from God and I get instructions in a situation, and then I step out and do what the instructions are, then whatever the issue is, it's dealt with. But we have a promise here from God. That as a result of fasting, that light shall break forth like the morning. In other words, there will be a breakthrough in your life of hearing from God. Now, I want to break this down just a little bit and kind of show you the dynamics of this. Go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And today I'm going to just really, some of this stuff is going to be stuff that maybe is very common to you, very simple, but we're going to break it down and really look at some of the mechanics of this. And we're going to break it down and look at why this is so absolutely necessary that we have a breakthrough of hearing from God. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse number 23. And you hear me talk about this quite often. And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray God your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So it says there that your whole spirit, soul, and body. And you guys hear me talk about this quite often, as it's not some great news flash to you, but we are a tripartite being, aren't we? Sometimes I use the word tripartite. Trichotomy, whatever, there's all kinds of these big theological words they use for that. But what it means is that basically we're spiritual being. Are we not? We are an eternal spiritual being. And we are going to live forever, are we not? Are we not?
Yes.
Okay, we can make sure. Hey, and we have a soul, do we not? And we have explained before what our soul is, and our soul is basically our thinking, our soul is our emotions in the context of this scripture, and our willpower. That's the best way to describe soul in this passage of scripture. And then we have our body. We all know our body, don't we? I mean, it's pretty easy to look around you and you can see everybody's body. And so we are a three-part-type being. We are tripartite being. And the important thing that we need to understand here is that God speaks to us how? Spirit to spirit, doesn't he? Romans 8:16 says the Spirit of God witnesses to our spirit that we are his child. The Spirit of God witnesses to our spirit that we are his child. It doesn't say the Spirit of God witnesses, it doesn't say God witnesses to our body. It doesn't say that God witnesses to our soul. It says that God witnesses to our spirit that we are his child. Amen? So when God communicates to us, God communicates spirit to spirit. Now, let me break that down and just make it real simple today in the sense of understanding what's taking place right now. Okay? God would use somebody like me or anybody who's called of God to stand up and do this. It's what's called the fivefold ministry in the Bible, that God gave gifts unto men, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry. And so God will call people, and then he will equip, prepare them, and to stand up and do what I'm doing right now. So in that sense, you can say that God is speaking to you. God is teaching you his word today, in the sense of I'm standing in front of you and doing this. Now let me break that down how I mean that. Now, God is not speaking to you bodily right now, is he? I mean, you can see my body. I mean, you can look at me and you can see my body, but this is not God communicating to you. He's not standing here. You're not looking at his flesh and blood. Correct? Now, I may break things down like I'm doing right now and try to explain things in a reasonable sense and bringing into our reason and our thinking as I'm doing right now, but God's not speaking to you right now through your reasoning necessarily. You can hear me. You can hear my thoughts. You can hear my thinking. You can hear my reasoning. But that's not necessarily how God is speaking to you. But see, then there's something else that comes into that element, that when I stand up here and I do what God has called me to do, if I properly prepared myself, and then there's an anointing of God here. So right now you can see my body, but this body's not God talking to you. Right now you can hear my reasoning and my thinking, but that's not necessarily God speaking to you right now. But right now there is an anointing of the presence of his Holy Spirit in this room, and he's talking to your spirit. He's communicating to you right now. That's why the Bible says that the Holy Spirit is a teacher. The Holy Spirit is the guide. The anointing that is on the inside of you teaches you. Now, he will use vessels like me, but it's really the Holy Spirit that's going to teach you today. If all you're going to hear today is what I got to offer, we might as well go home. Okay? The Holy Spirit's going to minister to us today, though. The Holy Spirit's going to teach us some stuff today. The Holy Spirit's going to give us some revelation of things today. And that's why I can stand up, I can teach the same thing, and the Holy Spirit can say one thing to JoJo, and one thing to Dave, and one thing to Nina, and just go around the room, and you can walk out of here, and God could have ministered to each and every person in different ways. Why? Because the Holy Spirit's speaking to your spirit. And that's what it means when it talks about the anointing. The anointing is the presence of God where the Holy Spirit speaks to your spirit. And so that's how God communicates with us. You see my body, you hear my voice, but the Holy Spirit is speaking to your spirit. You with me on that so far? So we're just breaking this down. I'm going to chew on this, like I said today, and we're going to walk out of here hopefully with some better understanding about what I'm talking about when I'm talking about revelation in this sense. We're spiritual beings, we have a soul, and we have a body. Now, one of the key parts of fasting here, one of the key elements is this, is it's like we have three avenues of communication, don't we? I mean, you can communicate somebody body to body, can't you? I mean, I can walk up and say, hey, Paul, what's up? And I can communicate to him. And really, I do this all the time, maybe in a crowd or something, I'll walk by somebody or somebody's talking and busy and I'm getting ready to leave or something, I'm going to say goodbye to them. I way. And we can communicate to each other with our reasoning and our thinking. And God can communicate with us spirit to spirit. So all three elements can communicate to a degree. So the thing about fasting, one of the things that I shared about fasting, is fasting gets the body to quiet down, and fasting gets the soul to quiet down so we can better hear the Spirit. Because those times when I'm talking about where it seems like the clarity's not there, where it seems like I'm not hearing from God, it's not because God's voice has changed. It's because something has changed with mine. And for some reason, my flesh or my body is too loud. For some reason, my emotions and my thinking is too loud. And I need them to hush so I can hear from God. And you know, it's almost like you got three TVs. I mean, you could have three TVs in a room, and they could all be tuned into different channels, couldn't they? And hearing different things. And, you know, when I hear these people talk about these sports reporters, talk about they're in these rooms with all these TVs going, so they watch all these games at the same time, they got to report on. I think, well, that's like crazy, wouldn't it? But you could have three TVs, and they could all be tuned into three different channels. And the same way, your body can be tuned into one channel and hear certain things. Our emotions, our thinking's tuned into one channel and hears on certain frequencies, but our spirit's on another channel and it hears things from God. So if we really want to hear from God and we got all three TVs going on at the same time, what we're looking to do with fasting is to turn down the one of the body, to turn down the one of the soul, and turn up the one of the spirit. And to bring us to a place where we're hearing with clarity, we have to silence the flesh, we have to silence the soul, so to speak, and we have to turn up the spirit by us. And that's one of the key elements that fasting will do. And if you'll stop and think about this a little bit, you'll realize there's times when your flesh is loud. There's times when your body's demanding some stuff. And if you allow your body or your flesh to dictate to you, the flesh gets stronger and the spirit gets weaker. And I talk about that all the time. Praise God. We want that to be quiet. All the time. When people begin to struggle in their walk with God, quite often what's happening is the flesh is taking over. And you'll see people then, what do? They fall out of church. Well, I can't go to church, this and this and this and this and this. The longer you allow the flesh to dictate, the harder it'll be to get back on track. Because every moment you make that decision, every day you do that, the flesh gets stronger and the spirit gets weaker. Same way with our emotions. People say, well, I just emotionally, I'm going through this, and I'm going through this, and I'm going through this, and I can't go to church, I can't do this, I can't do this. Every time you make that decision, you make the emotion stronger. The same principle works spiritually. Every time you spiritually make the right decisions, and you feed yourself spiritually, the spirit gets stronger, and the flesh and the soul gets weaker. So the thing that the key point about fasting here is it's the quickest route to get the other two TVs turned down and the spirit turned up. So that revelation will break through. And no matter what you're up against in life, no matter what battle you're in, I'll guarantee you the number one thing you need is to hear from God. That's the number most important thing. I don't care what you're up against. I don't care what the situation is. I don't care what the circumstances is. The number one need in your life is to hear from God about that situation. And that's the one thing I'm trying to impress upon us as believers. We find the same thing like Jehoshaphat did when he was surrounded by the multitude and they were in a situation. The first thing he did, we better pray and fast. The number one response in the battle should be, you know what, I need to hear from God. And the quickest way I know to hear from God is to go in a prayer, time of prayer and fasting. With me so far. Yes. Let me think here where I'm at. Let's go to Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16, and some of these are lines of scripture that you hear me talk about, and I don't necessarily go to them and specifically teach out of them, but they are scriptures that I refer to a lot. And Matthew chapter 16 is the account that I'm going to go to where Jesus asked Peter, who do men say that I am? And Peter says, well, you know, some say you're, you know, Elijah, some say you're Jeremiah, some say you're John the Baptist. And then Jesus narrows it down and says, but Peter, who do you say that I am? And that's where it gets real interesting. Jesus was, and nobody else did. They thought, well, he must be Jeremiah. He must be Elijah. He must be John the Baptist. Well, those are not ideals, I think. You see, well, let's go to verse 17. Verse 17, and Jesus answered, we're going to work backwards today, and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Barjotus, that Peter, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. Revelation, the light had broke through like the morning into Peter's life. And Peter had a moment where he heard from the Father, and he realized who Jesus was. But let us go backwards for a moment. And look at verse 13, where Jesus started at this conversation. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And then they go on, they said, well, you know, some say that you're John the Baptist. Some say you're Elijah. Some say you're Jeremiah. Now, that's a really odd thing, because I got news for you. All of those people are dead. Why did they think Jesus was a dead man? That's kind of odd, isn't it? Well, who did men say that I am? And Peter's just rattling off a bunch of names of dead people. Now, apparently, something has taken place here. You see, the carnal mind of man, when we're not functioning by spirit-to-spirit communication, when Peter was listening to the Spirit, Peter's hearing from the Father who Jesus is, but yet the rest of them are not hearing from the Father, they're not in spirit-to-spirit communication, but they're trying to figure it out with their own thinking who Jesus is. They're trying to reason it out, who is Jesus? And so they start coming up with all these weird theories. Now, apparently, they're attributing the supernatural power that Jesus is demonstrating to reincarnation. I'm looking at, what are you talking about? How can he be Jeremiah if Jeremiah's dead? How can he be Elijah if Elijah was dead? How can he be John the Baptist if John the Baptist was dead, if they didn't come up with some theory that apparently this is one of the prophets reincarnated? And the way I understand it, historically in that time in Israel, that was one of the false doctrines that was floating around, was they were believing in reincarnation. You see, people do the same thing all the time. They see some kind of supernatural event, and they try to explain it other ways than the Word of God, and they come up with goofy ideas. Let me give you one. I always like, some people believe in ghosts. I encounter that all the time. They believe that ghosts are real. Can I tell you something? That's not biblically correct. Your grandma's not floating around somewhere. I'm sorry, but if you just go back to grandma's house, because I know she's there, no, she's not. The Bible says that something happens when we die. Our spirit goes somewhere, doesn't it? It goes into heaven, or it goes to hell. But it's not floating around somewhere. But men have said, well, what about all that stuff? You can't tell me this didn't happen. I was in this house one day, and all this stuff started happening, and all this stuff started creaking, and I heard people walking and all kinds of crazy stuff. Now, you're telling me there's not ghosts? No, I'm telling you the Word of God says that all departed people are either in heaven or hell. I didn't say that what was happening in that house wasn't real. I just said that what men have come up with, the idea that that's some departed saint floating around somewhere, is not true, or some departed lost person is not true. When that person dies, they go to either heaven or hell. Period. So what's all that stuff happening in the house? Well, I've been sitting in that house all those years talking to grandma and she wasn't there. You've been talking to a demon. The Bible would explain that as demonic activity. But when we come up with our own ideas and our own thinking about what's going on. And so we have this long lost loved one. I've had this conversation with so many people. There is only one ghost.
That's the Holy Ghost.
The Holy Ghost. If the Bible's accurate, if the Bible's true, then our thinking about that is wrong. Amen. You can take a look at everybody's face and find you broke some hearts. I've been talking to Grandma all these years. But we run into trouble when we try to explain supernatural occurrences outside of the Word of God. And the carnal mind, if we're not functioning according to spirit revelation, then we're going to come up with goofy ideas. And we find the same thing today. Somebody gets healed. God heals somebody, and you'll hear the world come up with all kinds of goofy ideas why they got healed. Well, they weren't sick in the first place. It's just mind over matter. They will accept everything but the fact that somebody prayed and somebody got healed. They'll come up with all kinds of goofy ideas why they didn't happen. Or they'll see some manifestation of the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit, or what have you, and come up with all kinds of goofy ideas why that's not true. Because they're not functioning according to spirit communication. They're functioning according to their own thinking and their own mind. You see, we can't get it right without revelation from God. I mean, do you realize how much time and energy people spend trying to chase Grandma? Who's dead? I'm serious. And I don't mean it to be hard. I mean, I'm harsh to anybody. I realize we have lost loved ones, but can I tell you something? It's far more comforting knowing that my lost loved ones are in heaven and I'm going to meet them than just thinking they're floating around somewhere in a house.
Amen.
I don't want my family members floating around in a small house somewhere. Haunting people. I don't find that comforting. You see, the part we're looking at here, what we got to be concerned about, what men were saying about Jesus was entirely wrong. It was 100% wrong. They could not know who Jesus was without spirit-to-spirit communication. They had the Old Testament, they had the prophecies, they had everything there. But without revelation from God, they couldn't know who Jesus was. And I want to talk to you about that for just a moment. This world will never tell you the truth about Jesus. Not even Christmas time. This world will never tell you the truth about Jesus. This world will never tell you the truth about God. And I'm going to demonstrate in the scriptures why that's so important, that we're not listening to the world, but we're listening to God. Because you know what would have happened to Peter? What if he'd listened to what men say? What if he'd have been convinced of what they said was true? Yeah, you know, Jesus, they're saying that you're Jeremiah. They're saying you're Elijah. They're saying you're John the Baptist. They're saying you're some kind of reincarnation of something, I guess, Jesus. Now, what if he would have listened to what men said? He'd be in hell today if he hadn't heard from God. Amen? This ain't that serious, is it? I mean, think about this. How many of you think that you can go and as a child can grow up in a school system and hear the truth about Jesus? How many of you were taught all about Jesus in the school system? Probably didn't hear his name mentioned. If you did, it was somebody cursing. You know, it's kind of funny in the school system, they don't even study him in history. Why do they study? Why do they give a historical figure? Why do they at least study the history of Israel a little bit? But they totally ignore the name Jesus. They totally ignore the fact that he, even if you look at it historically, that he existed. They never mention that. Now, how many of you think that you can turn on the secular news and hear the truth about Jesus? You know, they make all these little shows they put on this time of year, you know, historical Jesus and all this stuff. I'm telling you the truth. They don't know anything about Jesus. They're trying to figure it out with their mind and their emotions, and they may come up with the 32, but that's, you know, that's Jeremiah reincarnated. That's John the Baptist. We just seen his head cut off, but that's him. think about it for a moment. I mean, even when they do mention Jesus, they mention him as a great moral teacher. They mention him as if he was a philosopher. But you'll never learn the truth about Jesus from this world. You know, that question then, when Jesus narrows it down, and says, but who do you say that I am, Peter? And if you doubt me about this, I'm going to challenge you with this. That's the most powerful question you can ever ask anybody. You want to totally change the entire atmosphere of a room, ask somebody, who is Jesus Christ? And I remember over the years, as witnessing to people and doing a lot of the street witnessing and stuff, and they used to do these surveys that they would ask people things. And you could, if you want to see a spiritual impact upon a situation, just look somebody in the eye and say, who do you say Jesus Christ is? And you watch what happens. They'll freeze and run away. Seriously. I mean, literally, you'll see people just panic and run away because they don't want to deal with that question. You see, Jesus was piercing right to the heart of the matter. Who do you say that I am? In other words, Peter, who are you listening to? Are you listening to what men say? Are you listening to what the world says? Or are you listening to what my Father is saying? Who do you say that I am, Peter? Who are you listening to? Are you listening to the voice of God, or are you listening to this world? If you're listening to this world, you're going to come up with all kinds of goofy ideas about who Jesus is. Can I share something with you? I don't want to sound harsh on this. But please, when they come up with all these goofy shows on TV about who Jesus is, you don't need to turn to that. Get your Bible. Go get on your face before God and listen to the Holy Ghost. He'll tell you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Don't seek information about God from the world. They don't know it. Hallelujah. You with me so far? Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I heard it. Too much heaviness in one day. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Why we need revelation, why we need to fast and hear from God. Because if we're getting our information from the world, we're being misled by the things of God. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 through 6. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, and whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. God had just, again, God who said, let there be light, had just spoke to Peter's heart and brought forth revelation of who Jesus was. The rest of those were blinded to who he was. Right? Now, case in point here. If you notice there, the God of this world or the God of this age. Now that's a little g, not a big g God. So we got to understand that this world system is not the product of God. This world system is not the handiwork of God. This mess out here is not God's work. And a lot of people get confused with that. You know, I always use the example of food. And, you know, I always get it, you know, and it's not funny, but people are seriously curious. And I say, well, if God's such a loving God, I'm going to say this nicely. Help me, Lord. If God is such a loving God, why are people in Africa starving to death? If God is such a loving God, why is people over there starving to death? Now, I have to answer the question back, well, why are we in America eating ourselves to death? Because there's plenty of food on this planet. But you see, if you look at this planet, part of the world's eating themselves to death, and the other part's starving themselves to death. The system's corrupt. There's plenty of food. There is no shortage of food on this planet. I mean, you would be amazed if you see that, and I don't remember what they are, the statistics for how much food we throw away in the United States a day and how many nations we could feed. And just go sit at Walmart and watch people walk in and see how many people look like probably they're eating too much food in America. You know what? It's all of the system. Look, they say every American eats too much, don't we? I mean, if we're honest, we probably eat more than we need for our well-being. But yet people are starving. It's not God's fault that some people have all the food and some people don't. God put plenty of food on this planet. You'll say, well, if God's such a loving God, why there's so much poverty? There's enough wealth on this world for all of us. There's plenty of wealth on this planet for everybody. But the system's corrupt. Some people got a lot, and some people have none. God put it here. It's not his fault what we do. Looking on it so far, go to Genesis 1:26. Let me show you that. Hallelujah. No, that's all I have to do. Genesis 1:26. This is all about fasting. Genesis 1:26. And God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God left us here kind of as managers. I mean, I use the example of a business. It's kind of like, if I own this business, and I'm going to be gone for a while, and I'm going to be gone a couple of years, maybe going on a long journey, and I leave a manager in place, I'm leaving that manager in charge of running that business for me. And it's kind of the same way with God. He gave us dominion to take care of this planet. And then something happened. Then Satan came into the garden. And when Satan came into the garden, man bowed the knee to Satan and kind of tucked that and handed it into Satan's hand. And that's why Satan was tempting Jesus. And he stood before Jesus tempting him. And Satan told him, he took him up, and he showed him all the kingdoms of the earth. And he said, if you'll just worship me, I'll give that to you. He says, for it's been delivered unto me to give to whomever I will. Now, if Satan wasn't right about that, then Jesus would have brought that unto his attention, wouldn't he? But Jesus didn't argue one with him. See, the day's coming when God's going to take this planet back.
Amen.
But right now, Satan, so to speak, is the little g god of this world. And that means something. That this world system is his product. And his purposes are clearly revealed in the Word of God. He comes to kill, steal, and destroy. Now, let me ask you a question. Is not this world system doing a good job of killing, stealing, and destroying?
Yes.
It's easy to look at it and see it's his handiwork. It's easy to sit back. If you don't think Satan's doing a good job at this world system of killing, stealing, and destroying, go home and watch the news network for a couple hours today. And let me ask you what you're going to hear. Killing, stealing, and destruction. In some way, shape, or form, you're going to hear those three things. Because that's Satan's handiwork. So let me take this one step further. Go to Ephesians chapter 2. I know I'm covering a lot, but I'm trying to cover a lot. And some of this, some of you is pretty familiar, and some of you is maybe brand new. But to really understand why it's important to hear from God, we've got to understand where we're used to hearing from. Ephesians 2:2. I'm going to begin verse 1. And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, that's the enemy, Satan, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. So prior to being born again, something's happened. We're walking according to the ways of this world. We have been shaped and molded. I came to Christ when I was 25, and like I share with people all the time, for the first 25 years of my life, Satan had his hand on my brain shaping and molding it. I wasn't listening to God. I didn't know anything about God's word. I didn't know anything about hearing from God. I was just getting all of my information from this world system that he's in charge of. Do you know what it says there in those scriptures that he blinds people? Do you know how Satan blinds us? Everyone in that, ever look at that question? How does Satan blind us? Satan blinds us by getting us to believe a lie. Once you believe a lie, you're blind. Imagine this. What did he do with Eve in the garden? God said, if you eat of that tree, you're going to die. And Satan came along and said, nah, nah, you won't die. That's the oldest lie in the world that people believe all the time. There's all kinds of people who believe that they can go out here and just run wild and sin and do whatever they want and not die and not suffer consequences. Satan has them blind to reality. The wages of sin is death. But he's got them to believe a lie that it doesn't matter how I live or what I do. So they're blind to the truth that the wages of sin is death. I mean, imagine if you hear enough lies about something, you begin to believe it, don't you? I mean, that's why the political strategy of our time with both parties is they just trash whoever the opponent is. Because they're convinced that if they share enough stuff, whether it's lie, true, it don't matter, about somebody, you'll believe it and vote against them. The trouble is both parties doing that. So everybody says, well, who do I vote for? They're both crazy. Yeah. I mean, that's what the result is. Or it's just like somebody in an abusive relationship. If you've ever been in an abusive relationship and you've had somebody telling you you're a piece of dirt for long enough, you begin to believe it, don't you? And you become blind to who you really are because you begin to believe the lie. And that's how Satan operates. Imagine this. Imagine there was some preacher and I didn't realize it, but somebody's going around to all you guys and just telling you lies about this preacher over and over and over about this terrible person, all the stuff he does, all the stuff he's doing, and just terrible life of sin, just, oh my goodness, and all that. And I didn't realize that this little culprit was going around telling you guys all this stuff, and next week he was a guest speaker. How many of y'all would be receptive to him? Probably not. Because when you hear a lie enough, you believe a lie. And when you believe a lie, you're blind to the truth. If you believe that person who's abusing you and telling you you're a piece of dirt, then you're blind to the fact that you're created in the image of God. You're blind to the reality of who you really are. So Satan blinds us by getting us to believe lies. So if we've been in this world system, no matter how long we were there, and we've been walking in this world system, listening constantly to this world system, and then we come to Christ, we've got to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. And beloved, it's absolutely essential that we hear from God. And we are changed and transformed by revelation from God. And one of the quickest ways that I can tell you to get there is to develop a lifestyle of praying and fasting and meditating in the Word of God and listening to the Holy Spirit. You're not going to get there by your reasoning. You're not going to get there by your thinking. You're not going to get there by academics. You're not going to get there by listening to the news. You're not going to get there by listening to your friends. You're not going to get there by listening to your family. You're only going to be transformed by hearing from God. And you need a breakthrough. And you need that light to break forth as the morning. Beloved, if there was ever a time or a day or an hour where God's people need to be walking and hearing revelation, we are in that day and hour that is spewing more lies than any time ever. Technology is wonderful. For God and for Satan, we have more information thrown at us than any time ever. And hence more information, hence more lies. And if we expose ourselves to enough times, and we're not hearing from God, and we're not hearing truth, and we're not hearing revelation from God, we will believe the lie. You may not mean, oh yes, yes you will. You hear something enough, you will eventually begin to believe it's true. And Satan knows that. So he can just throw all kinds of crazy stuff at us. There's a world of lost people out there, and the only reason they're lost is they believe lies about Jesus Christ. That's the only reason they're lost. If they had revelation of who he was, they would be like Peter. Say, you're the Son of God. And they fall at his feet and ask him to be their Lord and Savior. It's absolutely important that we hear from God. And there's nothing more important your walk and your relationship with God, that you learn how to hear from God. But if you're born again, you know how to hear from God. There's so much I haven't gotten into.
You're preaching more, Pastor.
I know.
Well,
stop there. Because I do want to go into these things and understand these basic, simple things. And just that we not only hear it, but we learn it. And we not only learn it, but we live it. And that's what's important. If you hear something enough, you'll believe it. So if I preach on the benefits of fasting enough, you'll start fasting. Amen? And in all seriousness, we're going to talk about some things too. Like some of you, I understand some people are, you know, diabetic or what have you, and that's, you know, not very feasible for you. But there are ways we're going to share with you that you can still begin to live a more fasting life. How does a diabetic fast? We're going to teach that for you. I mean, there's ways to do it. I mean, you know, there are, ideally in the Word of God, when it's talking about fasting, it's talking about not eating. But there are other ways that you can start getting some of the benefits of living a fasted life other than just, you know, not eating for 2 or 3 days, however long it is. And so we will get into those things as we get into it a little bit. Because like I said, I mean, you're taking insulin, you've got to have a certain amount of food and all that. We understand that. So we'll find ways to do that. But the reason I'm teaching on this is to understand, it's not just what I've taught today. To understand, it's about hearing from God. It's not about doing religious duty. Like some people think, well, look at me. I'm super spiritual. I went 3 days and fasted. Well, did you hear from God? No, then you didn't do nothing but quit eating. In all seriousness, that's not what it's about. It's not earning brownie points with God because you went out without food. It's really getting yourself to a place where you're hearing from God better. And that's what it's all about. You don't earn anything from God necessarily by fasting, though there are many promises of what will be the result of fasting. And the key point is here, is in that communication between you and God. It's not the fasting that earns something from God. It's hearing from God and then stepping out in faith in what you hear from God that brings the results. Amen? Amen. So that's really where I'm at. And this will probably go on for, it's going to take longer than I thought. I thought I'd cover a lot more today than I did. But praise God, let's have Gina come to the keyboard.